I'm sure it'll be fine. It'll all work out really good. Let's rejoice, rejoice. Christ is in you. Hello. We're double teaming today, Jim and I. Do you like our new singer? I personally think he's quite cute.
I'm called bottom of the barrel.
So it's been one of those weeks, you know, we've had we had a whole big team all organised up here, but people have got things going on, or somebody's got sick, or somebody's going on a holiday. So I was thinking, man, it's a good thing we live by grace, eh? You know, because you don't mind when we go off key, do you?
No.
No, exactly, because you guys are going to cover our backs, which is really, really great. But we're here to worship the Lord, and I want to say a big welcome to everybody this Queen's birthday this weekend. God bless the Queen for giving us an extra day, especially. And so she's an amazing Christian woman. If you haven't ever read her story, she's pretty incredible. So great to see you. Have we got any visitors here today? Not too embarrassed. We're here. Welcome. Good to see you. So usually we'd have a cup of tea out the back, but that will happen very soon. One day very soon. So firstly, I get the pleasure of praying for our birthday people. Now, who's having a birthday this week? Lynn. Oh, hold on, I have to put my mask on because I'm coming down. Where's my mask? There it is. Lynn. My special friend, Lynn. Who else is having a birthday?
Noah.
Noah. Gertrude. Well, I've got treats in here. Hold on, coming down. I've got treats for birthday people and for visitors as well. Lynn, happy birthday, Lynn. Are you 21 again? 21? Welcome. There we go. Lovely to see you today. Noah, are you 21 as well? Tomorrow, awesome. 20, is it 20? And Trudy. I've been 49 for a number of years now. It's a really good age to be 49. Isn't our display beautiful this week? Claire did that. I just love it. So beautiful. Well done, Claire. I think we should give Claire a big clap. Thank you, Claire, for taking the time. Really appreciate that. I'm going to pray for our wonderful birthday people. Let's do that now. Father, we just want a blessing upon all of our birthday people. There's a whole list up here: Heidi, David, Noah, Hannah, June, and Trudy. But Father, we just ask that you would be very close to them this week as they enjoy their birthday and hopefully some yummy cake and family around them, Father. Bless them, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I'm going to ask Jim now. He's going to actually pray for the offering and also for Ukraine and Russia. Okay? Yeah, we'll do one after the other, I guess. Yeah, see? This is good, eh? We can do this.
Thank you, sweetie. If in doubt, go to the Bible, right? So I was actually, for Ukraine, I actually read something in a psalm that I'll read part of it to you. But for tithes and offerings, the Lord says in his book that bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. So he also says further down that then all the nations you call will be blessed, for yours will be a delightful land. And we want a delightful land, don't we? So our tithes and offerings, the food in the food bank, the knitting that goes overseas, we'll just thank the Lord for that. So, Father, we thank you for the tithes and offerings given in person, in boxes, even with time, petrol, delivering things, the food that comes in here, the knitting and the time involved with that. We thank you for this, and we pray that these will go forward and make this a delightful land here in Caversham, here within the church, and throughout all New Zealand. So we thank you for that, Lord, and pray a blessing upon it in Jesus' name. And then, like I said, I was reading a psalm this week, and I thought, boy, this is just about what the situation in Ukraine. And it's Psalm 33, and I'll just read a couple of parts of it. 32. It says, just got to find it. Yep. Oh, come on. So, okay, here we are. The Lord, sorry. The Lord foils the plans of the nations, and that he will do that over in Ukraine. That's where we're going to pray. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples, but the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of his heart through all generations. Blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. From heaven the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place he watches all who live on the earth, he who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. Okay? No warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance despite all its great strength. It cannot save. Only the Lord can. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and to keep them alive in famine. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love rest upon us, rest upon Ukraine, Eastern Europe. Lord, we pray that the situation there be resolved quickly, that you be there with the people that are there. You bring in peoples who will help displaced families, bringing them food, encouragement, and love, the love of God, which is the only love that surpasses all understanding, as we know. So, Father, we pray that you bless Ukraine, the situation in Ukraine, and we pray for them and ask your blessing to go upon them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen and amen. Okay, thank you. Just a reminder that our darling Glenys, who passed away, I think earlier this week, last week, her funeral is on Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. here at Cavi. So that's for our lovely Glenys. So I'm going to ask Claire to come up now, and she's going to present all about Pentecost Sunday.
Right, good morning. So, last week was Ascension Sunday. This week is Pentecost, what we've all been waiting for. And without it, we wouldn't be Christians, would we? We wouldn't survive. I'm going to read this with you. We remember this day when your ancient followers waited, all together, obediently, expectantly. You came on cue as promised, like a wind, as a fire. No gentle breeze, no smouldering embers, but a roaring gale, an asthmatic flame. You've come like this before, in the burning bush, in parting the Red Sea. Fire and wind, the breath and kindling of life. Miraculously, simple fisher folk spoke, filled with you, talked in unlearned languages, telling your salvation love story. Thousands were baptized without catechetical classes. What a remarkable, revolutionary day. Centuries later, as predicted, we live at the ends of the earth. But the hurricane has subdued to a complacent breeze, and the raging fire dampened to a comfortable temperature. I confess, languages are not my strength. With failed fourth form French and rudimentary Bengali, I need te reo. Or how will the tangata whenua learn of your love if it's not in their heart language? Lord, stir us once more. Move us up a knot in the Beaufort wind scale and blow away our apathy. Singe us with your blaze. Your work is not finished. Wind and fire, give us your strength.
Thanks, Claire, that's awesome. Okay. Trailblazers and Quest If you want to go out to a program, your program now, that would be absolutely fine. And Bravo, you're staying in this morning. So Trailblazers and Quest, you're out in your programs, and Bravo is in. Have been a real challenge. Family members who have been very unwell and who have got days to live. I myself have had an injury in my ankle for years and years and years, and I have got to have a full ankle replacement, which is a good thing, but it's also going to put me out of action for quite a while. And there have been times when, you know, the pain is so bad in my ankle that I actually have to take a walking stick to school or not go to school. And so, you know, there's been times when I've just had to say, your joy and strength each day I find, and that my soul knows very well. And you know, all of us have stuff in our lives, all of us. None of us are exempt. And I think it's where our strength does come from. Where does our strength come from? And, you know, when we realize that we can sit in the very presence of our Lord and He will renew our strength, that is incredibly liberating, no matter what the situation is. And so we're going to now sing, Lord, I Come to You.
Thank you.
thank you, Lord. We thank you that you are present here today. You are present here today. You are lifting up our hands and our arms and strengthening our feet and strengthening our heart, Father, for the things to come. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, as Murray comes now and she is communing in the word to us this morning, we ask that you would give him the words to say, Father, that you would give him the unction and the leading of your Holy Spirit, your gentle and beautiful Holy Spirit, as he speaks to us words from your heart, Lord. In Jesus' name we all prayed. Amen.
Good morning. I'm just wondering what to do. I really appreciated that poem, Claire. Did you write that? Fair swag of it, by the looks. Yeah. It just made me stop and think about how much of God, you know, how dependent on God we are and how much we're dependent on his Holy Spirit. And it got me thinking about that. If we really believe that we're in the end times, you know, as we say and proclaim, I sort of think of that Peter, when he's doing the Day of Pentecost sermon, and he quotes Joel the prophet. And I was just looking at those verses, you know. He says, and he's talking as he addresses the crowd, and he says, in the last day, God says, I'll pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Man, there's hope for me yet. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I'll show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Boy, aren't we seeing those? Blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. This is a cool verse. Verse 21. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Isn't that cool? This is where he starts his sermon on Pentecost. That is, the Holy Spirit will be poured out on all people. And today is Pentecost Sunday. And how much more do we need the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to come upon us in a fresh way? That we will prophesy, that we will see visions, but we will dream dreams in God about what does God still want to do in and through us, extending his kingdom in this place. What is the word of the Lord that is coming to us? And what is God saying to us as a people? What's the vision? What vision has God placed in your heart, breathed upon by his Holy Spirit? For you, for your family, for your household, for this place. And man, to me it just seems that if there was an outpouring of the Holy Spirit 2,000 years ago, how much more do we need it today? So that people will come to know Jesus Christ as Lord. Yeah.
Murray?
Yes, Peter.
Seeds in each of us, the Lord desires for them to take further
No, don't apologize for that, bro. That's cool. Yeah, let's pray, eh? Father, we just want to say thank you for your faithfulness. And today, this particular Sunday at Pentecost, we just come to you and say, Father, come and breathe upon us in a fresh new way, that those roots in you may grow deep and that there may be a harvest of righteousness in this place. Lord, that as we lift you up, that you may draw all people unto yourself, that people may call upon the name of the Lord. And Father, I just pray for each and every one of us in this room that we may have a fresh revelation of just how awesome you are, and that you may just breathe upon us afresh, that we may rise up to be the sons and daughters of the Lord that you've called us to be, I pray, in this place. And that your kingdom may come, and that your will be done. Yeah, Father, and that you may be glorified. We say thank you, Father, for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning, as part of our service, we're going to participate in communion together. And as we do that, I want to read a short paragraph from this book from Todd Boltzinger. It's called It Takes a Church to Raise a Christian. And it simply says this: today, like most days, people will gather around tables, coffee tables, drawing tables, breakfast and dinner tables, boardroom tables, picnic tables, and school tables. Families will discuss problems, joys, and the details of the day. Deals will be made and divorce settlements finalized. Papers will be signed and friendships will be renewed. Milk will be spilt and puzzles will be built. Homework will be done and bills will be left unpaid. The table, maybe more than any other item, is universal, necessary, and ordinary. It is around tables that life is lived. And it is at tables that, perhaps unexpectedly, God can be found. Yeah. And I really like that last phrase in there. It is at tables that perhaps unexpectedly, God can be found. And so this morning we come to this table, and a table where God can be found. And hopefully as we come to this table, more than any other table, we will expect to find God. We expect to meet with God. It was while Jesus and his disciples were reclining at a table while they were enjoying Passover, something that they would have done a multitude of times throughout their lifetime, that Jesus took a piece of bread and he gave thanks for it and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and declared, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after they'd shared the bread together, Jesus took a cup and he proclaimed, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As we gather around this table this morning, we declare the Lord's death until he comes. This table, more than any other table, reminds us of the price that the Father paid for you and I so that we could have a relationship with him. This is a table where the ultimate deal was made. The unrighteous were made righteous. For this is a table of forgiveness, a table of reconciliation, a table of relationship. This is a table where the love of the Father is revealed to each and every one of us. This is a table where God is found in two very simple elements: the bread and wine. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, Paul wrote, "And we all, who have unveiled faces, contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. In his commentary on this verse, John Calvin states that our encounter with the glory of the Father is at the communion table, because it is here more than anywhere else as we gather, as God's redeemed people, and remembering that what the Father has done for each and every one of us. It is in remembering that we find God. For it is at this table that we encounter his holiness, his grace, his love, his forgiveness. And we're reminded that God loves us and the price that he paid for each and every one of us. For he sent his son to die for us. Let's pray. Father, we want to say thank you for these simple, everyday emblems. And yet we can hardly begin to comprehend what's behind them. Of your amazing love, your amazing grace, that you sent your son to die for each and every one of us. And we thank you, Father, for that. And this morning, as we partake of these emblems, Lord, may we be reminded of that. May we encounter Jesus in a new way today. On this Sunday, Pentecost Sunday, as we remember that you sent your son to die for each and every one of us. Father, we say thank you for that. May we meet with you in a special way around this table this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, Judith. Partake in your own time.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling.
Father's arms are open.
of forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Powerful words, eh? Well, this morning we're going to continue our journey looking at the Sermon on the Mount, particularly in Matthew chapter 6. Now, in these first 18 verses of Matthew chapter 6, Jesus has been describing what we might call three sacred acts of righteousness. And Noah did an outstanding job last week looking at fasting. And Sandra, the week before, introduced us to the Lord's Prayer. And the week before that, it was about almsgiving. Three acts of righteousness. But in verse 19, where we come to this morning, there's a transition in Jesus' focus and what he presents for the rest of this chapter. And in effect, it moves to what we might consider more practical terms, everyday terms, frustrations, or the practical concerns of life, as he challenges us about our attitude towards material possessions. And Stott points out that God is concerned about both areas of our lives, both the sacred and the secular, as it were. And within these five verses that we're looking at this morning, we see Jesus talking about two treasures. There's one on earth and there's one in heaven. There's two body conditions. There's a healthy and an unhealthy. There's light and darkness. And there's two masters. He talks about two masters, God and money or wealth. And then in the remaining verses of the chapter, there are two preoccupations. Our bodies, looking after this body, and God's kingdom. And in these five verses that we're looking at this morning, Jesus sets out the false and the true, and he puts them side by side. He compares both of them and against each other, as it were, and he invites us to compare, to look at them, to evaluate them, to come and decide which one will be the master of our life. Which of these two things is going to be master of our life? God or earthly concerns? Because he says we cannot have both. As the old Bob Dylan song goes, everyone has to serve somebody. So be careful who or what you serve. And as Jesus tells us, ultimately, our choice will be centered around what we treasure the most. What rules our hearts? Is it the things of God or the things of this age? See, once again, Jesus is concerned about what is going on in here with our inner self. So let's have a look at these first few verses. Well, if you've got your Bibles, it might come up on the PowerPoint. Okay, Matthew 6, starting in verse 19, it says this: Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be. There your heart will be. In these first three verses, Jesus draws our attentions to the durability of treasures. And who doesn't like the idea of treasure? I mean, you know, who doesn't want to find treasure? You know, sort of pulls up the old image of pirates, doesn't it? You know, treasure maps, those sorts of things. It allows your imagination to run away. You know, X marks the spot. You know, everyone wanted to be a pirate. If you weren't a cowboy, you were a pirate. But just like pirates, people in the ancient Near East, this is before banks, remember? The BNZ and the ANZ and all those sorts of banks. Okay, people used to hide their wealth. They literally hid it so that people couldn't come along and steal it. And sometimes they would bury it in the ground. And that's the background of the parable in Matthew chapter 13 that we looked at Was it last year or the year before? The problem with it was, if Dad went and hid the family jewels out in the paddock somewhere and then went off to war, or the invading army was coming along, and he didn't return from war and didn't tell anybody where it was hidden because he didn't trust anyone, the family lost the wealth and they became vulnerable. Okay? Because no one knew where he had hidden it. He didn't even tell his wife often. Sometimes pests would come and vermin would come along and they would totally destroy it. One of the ways of showing wealth in the ancient Near East was you wore nice clothes. We do a little bit of that today, don't we? I won't try and name any brand names because I'll get them wrong. But, you know, we have the fashion industry to show that, hey, I got a bit of dough and I can afford nice clothes. And moths, though, would come along and eat them. Or mice would come along and eat your nice clothes even. Sometimes thieves would literally burrow through the side of your house because the clay houses, they would burrow through the mud brick walls of people's homes and they would steal anything of value. So even if it was in your home, it wasn't necessarily safe. So earthly wealth can easily be lost. Even today, we can lose wealth. Do a bad investment. Funds can be devalued. We can lose shares. Shares can be devalued. You can get overseas currency. That can be devalued. You know, things can get lost. You think you've got it all sorted out, but we can lose wealth. And these verses remind us that earthly treasures, they're not as long-lasting as we would hope. Yeah, we hope to leave an inheritance for our kids and grandkids, but it doesn't always work out like that. But as we look at these verses, there's a couple of things that we want to draw, or I want to draw your attention to. The first is that verse 20 is a verbatim repetition of verse 19, except that the focus in verse 20 is on heaven rather than on earth. And likewise, in verse 20, it has the necessary negatives that are not in verse 19 to show the contrast. For example, moths and vermin do not destroy, thieves do not break in and steal. And the phrasing in verse 19, "do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth," can equally be translated as "stop storing up for yourselves treasures on earth." Okay? Don't make for yourself just a treasure down here. And the key word in this verse is "for yourself." Don't just hoard it all for yourself. That's difficult. Because we all like nice things. Heidi this week was renting a car for us to go to Hui. Well, anyway, I said, "Oh, did you get the Mustang GT version?" She said, "No." You know, we like nice things, don't we? Yeah. Don't worry, we got the budget version. Just before you all start sending me emails. It was just a joke in the office, so I thought I'd share. Before you all get serious. Okay? Don't store up for yourselves treasure on it for yourself. See, Jesus doesn't state that we can't own property or that it isn't wise to put money away for a rainy day. In fact, Scripture commends the ant to us as a creature that is wise in making provision for the future. What he is condemning is the selfish accumulation of goods and wealth, an extravagant self-focused lifestyle. And man, don't you see so much of that on TV lately with how people are living their lives? When I was at Tear Fund, we had a mantra that simply went, "live simply so others could simply live." And Luke warns us to guard against every kind of greed. To contrary what is portrayed on TV, life is not measured by how much you own. And sometimes we forget that. We buy into that thing, the person who has the most toys wins. But Jesus is challenging that thinking, that mindset. See, even if it lasts a lifetime, we can't take it with us. Job was right when he said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart." Both verses 19 and 20 talk about moths and rust consuming or not consuming our treasure. The NIV has this translated as moths and vermin, picking up the idea from the Greek of brosis, that of being eaten away, whether that be by an insect, whether that be by rust, whether that be by rot, that sense that this treasure that you have will be eaten away by something. Once again, reminding us that these earthly wealth, it doesn't last forever. Rather, Jesus tells us in verse 20, "But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven." The frustrating part for me is in this verse, Jesus doesn't actually then say, "Well, here's all of this. Here's the treasures in heaven." Wouldn't that have been a simple thing to have done? You know, verse 21, "Here's the treasures." Wonder why he didn't do that. So in these verses, he doesn't actually tell us what the treasures are in heaven. And yet, fortunately, as we look through all of Scripture, it is not silent on the matter. You know, we're encouraged to become a people who reflect God's nature and character, the attributes of the kingdom of heaven, of loving our enemies. Sometimes it's hard enough to love our friends, let alone love our enemies. But Jesus tells us we're to love our enemies, to grow in faith, hope, and love, to grow in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Learn to hear the Father's voice and to obey those promptings of the Spirit. To share our faith with others so that they too may inherit eternal life. We're called to be generous with what we have. We've got with the things that God has blessed us with. Helping others that are less fortunate than ourselves. That aspect of almsgiving that we looked at a couple of weeks ago. And there's heaps and heaps more of things. These earthly activities have eternal consequences, not just for us, but also for the recipient. When you lead someone to Christ, you share them about the love of Jesus, you help a person in need. If you want a safe, long-term investment, invest in things that are eternal, where rust and moth cannot destroy it. And when you become before the throne of heaven, you'll be so pleased that you did, because it is then that we will inherit a kingdom that was prepared for us before the foundation of the world. See, so much about the Sermon on the Mount is focused on our heart, that inner person, what's going on here, that seat of our understanding, our knowledge, our will, what's taking place in here. When the teacher of the law asked Jesus, "What is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus' response was, "To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." Because you see, he knew that whatever has our heart has us. In these three verses, Jesus simply asked the question, is it worldly wealth or is it the things of God? Plummer encourages us to store our wealth above in order that our hearts may be drawn upwards. Isn't that a great way of saying that? Store your wealth in heaven because it turns your heart upwards towards the Father. What a great way of summarizing those three verses. Let's turn now to verses 22 and 23. These two verses are really interesting, a little bit curly. Many commentators say that these two verses are two of the most difficult verses in all of the Gospels. These two verses. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? Often within Scripture, the eye is equivalent to the heart. That is, to set your heart on something or to fix your eyes on something is basically saying the same thing. And we see a classic example of this in Psalm 119. And in verse 6, the psalmist writes, I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments. And then in verse 10, he pens, with my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me stray from your commandments. And in these two verses, he's declaring a desire to follow the Lord and his commandments with everything he has. And in verses 22 and 23 in Matthew here, Jesus is focusing our attention on an undivided commitment to the Father. And he's using that metaphor of healthy, unhealthy, of light and darkness. And in verse 22, he states, if your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Weird statement. In ancient times, it was believed that the eye was the source of light for the body, that somehow that light was needed to be on the inside of my body. And that light actually came out of my body and it interacted, so I see this chair, it interacts with the chair and then it goes back into my body. Weird statement. That's what they thought at the time. Yeah. But what we have translated here as healthy is an ethical term rather than a biological term. And it points to the idea of being wholly devoted to God, of being single-minded in our devotion to the Lord with a generosity of heart, not dissimilar to what the psalmist was writing about. Some manuscripts translate haplos as good as they try to encapsulate this whole idea, these tensions of what it is. Because when the light of God is shining in our lives, there will be a generosity of spirit with us. You follow that? That sort of love of the Lord, that light of the Lord, there will be generous people. Will be a blessing to others, especially with the things that God has given us. We won't just be old and stingy and hanging on to things. We have a healthy orientation towards the Father. We want to be Father pleasers in how we treat others. Which is in contrast to verse 23, where Jesus declares that if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. And the Greek word translated as unhealthy here has a connotation of producing great wickedness in a person's life. If you're unhealthy, you're producing wickedness in your life. It's the same Greek word that's used at the end of the Lord's Prayer in verse 13, where we pray, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. There's a stinginess in our lives. There's a meanness of spirit. It's that self-focus, that selfish greed that we struggle with. And in this context, in these two verses, it means that we keep all our wealth for ourselves and refuse to help others. And this is described as an absence of light in your life. And it produces a great wickedness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? If we're not open up to the things of the Lord, how great is that darkness that is within us? And in this, Jesus is referring to a moral darkness, that invades our life. So there's a bit of a wordplay that's going on here between being single-minded about our devotion to the Lord and having a generosity like that with that and a hallmark of discipleship and all those sorts of things, and having that evil eye who hoards and keeps earthly possessions for themselves only to see them decay before their eyes, as it were. But a good, healthy eye doesn't look with envy at another person's decaying wealth, but will seek after kingdom values and store up for themselves non-decaying treasures in heaven. See, in these two verses, Jesus calls us to examine our heart, because what we look at, what we dwell upon, affects the whole body and impacts how we live our lives. Is it for God and His kingdom? Or is it for us? Excuse me. Then in verse 24, Jesus declares this: no one can serve two masters. Either they will hate one and love the other, or they will be devoted to the one and despise the other. They cannot serve both God and money. Excuse me. We all know that verse, don't we? Huh? And we all know that aspect, that you cannot serve two masters. But part of that is partially untrue, because often we serve two masters. Especially if you've got a part-time job. You might have two bosses. You might work for two different companies. Ooh, you're all thinking now, aren't you? Murray's gone into heresy. You know, when I was working for Transen, and I was working part-time for them, and part-time for Mangere Baptist. You know, I was half and half, and I found that really hard, because in effect you got two bosses, and you always felt like you were letting one down. You know, you weren't doing enough, because it was part-time, both work. And neither of them had 100% of my attention, or my energies. You know, you'd just be walking out the door one at 12 o'clock and go, excuse me, can I just catch you for a minute, Murray? And you knew it was never going to just be a minute. You know, it was going to be another half hour sort of thing. It happens all the time. But what underlines this verse is we're not talking about employee-employer situation. What underlined this is slavery. And what we have translated as serve here either describes the status of a slave or the attitude of a slave. And although it was unusual for a slave to have two masters, there's an example of a slave girl in Acts 16 that had more than one owner. And also, the Talmud contains a case where a slave girl was owned by two brothers. Now, this is weird. Okay? So two brothers owned this slave girl. One brother sets her free. The other brother doesn't. So how can you be half free? So you cannot serve two masters in that aspect. It's impossible to give two masters both your total allegiance and 100% of your attention. And this is Jesus' point here. When the two masters are both God and wealth, you cannot serve them both, because their demands are polar opposites. Possessions demand self-centered living. If you're going to build up millions and billions of dollars, it becomes a bit of a monkey on your back, doesn't it? You're generating money for the sake of generating money for the sake of generating money. Well, God demands that we serve others. And He uses this dualism of hate and love to describe this. We will love one more than the other, or we will reject one and prefer the other. We will be devoted to the one and despise the other, He says. It's impossible to hate something and love something at the same time. Particularly with the biblical understanding of these two words, because it's more encompassing than just our emotions. You know, you can sit there and you're feeling really aggro about something. You say, man, I hate that. You know, that's not what he's talking about. He's not talking about an emotional state of hate. Okay? It means to completely reject something. Something that would hinder our commitment to the Father and the kingdom of heaven. It's a total way of life, is what he's talking about. And Jesus says that you cannot love God or serve both God and money with that sort of commitment. The choice is ours. But the decisions that we make have eternal consequences, because we cannot serve both masters. We either give our all to our Heavenly Father, the great I am, the one who is loved, the one who loves us and holds us in the palm of his hand, the one who wants the very best for us, or we serve something of our own making, in this case, wealth. And, but by doing that, we break the second commandment. You shall have no other gods before me. Because if you're going to love and serve money, you have in effect made it a god in your life, which is idolatry. And we don't tend to think of it in those terms, but we have. And even though it seems inconceivable that anyone would exchange earthly treasures for temporal wealth, people do it all the time. Because the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. Craig Bloomberg says that wealth is arguably the biggest competitor for authentic Christianity for the hearts and souls of millions in our world today, including many in our churches. Materialism, in this sense, has become a false religion, and wealth has become a false religion, and wealth idolatry. And if we've been truthful with ourselves, most of us would have to admit that we struggle with that to some degree. We all do. How many of us have sat there and fantasized and said, man, I wonder what it would be like if I won Lotto on the weekend? We all do it. If we're honest with ourselves, we all think, ooh, I'd like that new car. Like a bigger house. We all do it to some degree. But in these verses, Jesus challenges us about where is our heart at? What's happening in here? Are we focused on living in a loving relationship with our Heavenly Father and serving him with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our strength? Or do we have undivided loyalties? Because we can't serve two masters at the level of commitment that authentic discipleship demands and requires of us if we're going to be followers of Jesus. Anything that comes between us and the Father must be forcefully removed from our lives. Because as his disciples, we're called to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness above everything else. And that's what he calls us to if we want to be authentic followers of Jesus. To seek first his kingdom and his righteousness above all. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are a great God. Thank you for what you call us into. And Lord, we come to you today, and you know our hearts. And I just pray that you will continue to touch our hearts, renew our hearts, renew our love of you, that we may indeed seek you first, to put you first in all things in our lives. Help us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Mary. So our final song today is a YouTube clip. So we're going to be watching Kerry Underwood singing How Great Thou Art. So this is something I often play this in my office, at work, at home, and I just sit and I just enjoy the presence of the Lord, and I'd like you to do the same. Just sit and enjoy, and if you want to sing, sing, but just enjoy worshiping in your heart How Great Thou Art.
You are God's servant, gifted with dreams and visions. Upon you rests the grace of God like flames of fire. Love and serve the Lord in the strength of the Spirit. May the deep peace of Christ be with you, the strong arms of God sustain you, and the power of the Holy Spirit strengthen you in every way. Amen. Amen. May the Lord bless each and every one of you.